Okay, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Our today's lecture is the continuation of our previous lecture. In our previous lecture, we understand some definitions. Among them, definition of the drug product performance and also the definition of biopharmaceutics. We have already learned about the definition of drug, dosage form. These were the minimum definitions which are included in the definition of the biopharmaceutics. And the previous class, I was at the dose response curve. And I have told all of you, these dose response curve is actually have the two major areas, two major approaches. One is pharmacodynamic approaches. In my previous class, I already told you about the pharmacodynamical approaches of this dose response curve. Are the curve which shows the concentration time curve. These are basically two terms, dose response curves, when we increasing the dose of the drug and we are taking the response therapeutically. And in case of pharmacokinetic behavior, when we check the concentration of drug in the blood or the plasma, with the passage of time, we find increase in the concentration. But at the maximum stage, then it will decrease in the concentration. We have another area, curve is, especially we write there concentration, and we already discussed its units. Its units were microgram per ml, ppm, ppb, percentage mass by volume, and also many other units we can write. And here I am writing microgram per ml, and there is a time. Time can be measured in minutes, hours, and different time intervals we got the different concentration of drug in the plasma. Now this curve, which I have already told you in the pharmacodynamic approach, now I am discussing about its pharmacokinetic approach. In the pharmacokinetic approach, how many parameters we can measure? We can, first of all, we can measure the different segments. These will be called trapezoids, and the rule will be called trapezoidal rule. And the whole scenario which we'll measure is AUC, area under the curve, from the graph. Okay. Another thing is AUMC, area under the first movement curve. From the same graph, we can measure MRT, mean residence time. From this same graph, we can measure the absorption phase. And here we can write absorption rate constant, which is KA. From these lines, we can measure KE, elimination rate constant, KE. From the top, we can measure Cmax, maximum concentration of drug in the plasma. Same way, at time Tmax, the time at which maximum concentration present in the plasma. And for same way, we can calculate T half, elimination T half. And same way, we can calculate absorption T half. These are some parameters which we can measure from the same graph, which we have already discussed about MEC in our previous class, minimum effective concentration, MTC, minimum toxic concentration, and also onset of action, duration of action, intensity, and all subtherapeutic level, therapeutic level, and all the toxic level. That was our previous discussion, which was regarding the pharmacodynamic approach. And the same way, in case of pharmacokinetic approach, we can measure all these parameters, and these parameters will be calculated in each and every dosage form. In my previous lectures, I told about the syllabus of our Form D curriculum, in which we will discuss the pharmacokinetic profiles of the injectables and also the orals and also IV infusions, even one compartment following, two compartment or multiple compartment, and then we will calculate all these parameters. These parameters are called the basic pharmacokinetic parameters, which we'll understand as we move toward the different dosage form behavior. Another area of the area is some abbreviations which we are using in our routine pharmacokinetic approach. One is the behavior of the drug or the start of the drug is starting from the raw material, and the raw material can be obtained from the plants and also the other sources, and we will write its starting material, SM. And this starting material will convert into API, active pharmaceutical ingredient. And for the conversion of this starting material into the API, there is an organization which will allow us to say this starting material is an API, which is called FDA, Food, Drug and Administration Authority, which give us the permission. You can say this starting material into API, but this is not a small journey. It's a long journey to become a starting material to the API. During the conversion of this starting material into API, we have a different areas, different approaches from which, first of all, if we're discussing about the plant source, we will have to make the some extraction, then it's purification, then is identification, and then is analysis by using the analytical techniques. Then we can confirm, okay, this is a constant which we can, it's a starting material just like a drug. By taking the opportunity to understanding all these things, then we will move toward the for the application, filing of the application, which will be called NDA, New Drug Application, and this application will be honored by the FDA. This FDA will give the another name of the another area, another approaches to make some these are some studies in animals and then in human beings and then also the other things. In case of when for their new drug application is will be applied for new and ANDA, especially during this class we will also understand the word ANDA and NDA. This NDA is new drug application for the new molecule, and ANDA is a new drug application for the generic molecules, the molecules which are newly come in the body, not newly come in the market, but they have an other research brands, they have another reference brand present in the body, already present in the market, then we will say this is the ANDA. And these are approved by the different bodies, among them FDA, and in case of European areas, European pharmacopoeias, these are the pharmacopoeias where the all details of the components are present. Now we will discuss how many factors affecting on the biopharmaceutics, especially the design of the drug product, stability of the drug within the drug product, manufacture of the drug product, the release of the release form of the drug product, the rate of the dissolution, release of the drug at the absorption site, delivery of the drug to the site of action, which may involve targeting the drug to localized area for action or systemic absorption. These are the basic parameters which you can say in the different books. And design of the drug product means design of the dosage form, and these are the also the factor which are involved in the biopharmaceutics, and also other factors which I have already told you. These factors will be discussed in our next classes. In case of pharmacokinetics, we will see the two areas. One is experimental approach and other is theoretical approach. When we use the word pharmacokinetics, which is actually branch of the biopharmaceutics, I have already made this biopharmaceutics can be divided into pharmacodynamics and pharmacokinetics. This pharmacokinetics can be measured by two ways. One is experimental analysis and other is statistical analysis. In case of experimental analysis, we gave a drug to the patient, to the volunteer, and volunteer is using the drug, and we take the some samples from the body. From where? From plasma, from urine, from sweat glands, from skin, from hair, from other areas, from nails. We can measure the concentration of drug by creating the some standard protocols. These are our experimental approach. In case of experimental approach, we can check the different parameters. We can check its maximum concentration, its metabolism, its absorption, its distribution, even elimination or excretion. Every parameters we can calculate by the experimental point of view. But in case of statistical analysis, statistical approaches, we can predict either the concentration of drug is in the body at the particular organ is at which concentration is present in the stomach, how much concentration is present in the systemic circulation by predicting the values of the drug concentration. And this prediction will be called statistical analysis. These statistical analyses are basically done by some softwares, and softwares are those software especially for the prediction. We can measure measure the concentration, but also we can measure its protein binding and other parameters. Means you have already known the word computational chemistry, computational areas. By using the some computational techniques, we can calculate the pharmacokinetic analysis by the statistical methods. And these models, mathematics and computers are the basic phenomena which are involved in this in the statistical approaches. In case of pharmacodynamic studies of the biochemical and physiological effect of the drug on the body, this include mechanism of the drug actions. In case of pharmacodynamics, it includes the mechanism of actions of the drug and the relationship between the drug concentration and effect. A typical example of the pharmacodynamic is how the drug interacts quantitatively with the drug receptors to produce the response, means effect. The word effect is basically the basic phenomena of the pharmacodynamics. And kinetics is basically the movement. Effects, movement. What will be the effect of the drug at the particular receptor site, particular area? That would be called the pharmacodynamics. And what will be the concentration of the drug at the particular site, particular area? That will be called the pharmacokinetics. Receptors are the molecules that interact with the specific drug to produce the pharmacological effect in the body. And the pharmacodynamic effect sometimes referred to as the pharmacological effect also. Another name of the pharmacodynamics are pharmacological effect. Now, pharmacokinetic also subdivided into the clinical pharmacokinetics. These are the type of kinetics in which we discuss about the patients. In the routine areas of the pharmacokinetics, blood studies, plasma studies, plasma concentration studies, we use the volunteers. The volunteers are the word which comes from the healthy people. And healthy people may be the young people or male or female. These are called the volunteer. If we take the samples from the volunteers and check the experimental analysis, if we predict the samples of the volunteers and analysis by the computational technique, we will call the pure pharmacokinetics. But when we use the patients, these are called the clinical pharmacokinetics. And these clinical pharmacokinetics are large number of depend on the large number of the patients are enrolled in the clinical trial to determine the efficacy and optimum dosing regime. FDA approves a label because the packaging insert discussed in more detail later in this chapter. Especially in this we will discuss when we write the labeling claims, how many concentration of the patient, the amount of the drug a patient can be used. These are developed by taking the phase 4 studies in which we use the some clinical setups and also the some those individuals which who are involved with that particular diseases. The main segment in the clinical pharmacokinetic is therapeutic drug monitoring, TDM, for every potent drug, such as those with the narrow therapeutic range, in order to optimize efficacy to prevent any adverse toxicity. Therapeutic drug monitoring, TDM, is a major areas where we check, we calculate the different areas, and if those, particularly those drugs which are having the narrow therapeutic index. Therapeutic index, I have already told in your in my previous class, where we make some graph and we said that there is some levels. One is MEC and other is MTC, and the difference between them, MEC and MTC, is called the therapeutic window, and the ratio of the MTC and MEC will be called the therapeutic index. If we have the narrow therapeutic index, it means we have very low margin of the therapeutic range, we will call these are the drugs who are following the narrow therapeutic index values, and these can be monitored by the therapeutic drug monitoring. For these drugs, it is necessary to monitor the patient either by monitoring plasma drug concentration, for example theophylline, or by monitoring a specific pharmacodynamic endpoint such as prothrombin clotting time, warfarin. And pharmacokinetic and drug analysis services necessary for safe drug monitoring are generally provided by the clinical pharmacokinetic services. Another term is CPKS, clinical pharmacokinetics PK services. These are the terms which are pharmacists are working nowadays, and they are monitoring the not only the concentration of the drug within the plasma, but also the different and adjusting their doses to prevent the some adverse effects. CPKS, clinical pharmacokinetic services. Some drugs frequently monitored are the aminoglycosides and anticonvulsants. Other drugs closely monitored are those used in the cancer chemotherapy and to minimize the adverse effects. Therapeutic drug monitoring, when we discuss about the clinical pharmacokinetics, we will discuss about the TDM, we will discuss with the CPKS, clinical pharmacokinetic services. Among them, we will check, okay, what the amount of the drug is. Is it in the therapeutic range or in the toxic range? And then we will adjust in the case of CPKS. Another term we will use, pharmacogenetics. Pharmacogenetics. These are the terms which we can say we are belongs to the Asian countries, and we have our different body mass index, we have our diet is different, and our living style is different. But when we see our trials, phase 1, phase 2 and phase 3 trials, clinical trials, especially those drugs which are introducing from the other areas, other parts of the world, from the Europe, from the other even USA, the people have their different diets. They have their different climates, they have the different lifestyle, they have the different their habits. When they use the same drug and having the same therapeutic effect, and they are registered by the FDA as a API, active pharmaceutical ingredient. But our claim is, when they bring these drugs into our community, our community is not just like those people's. Our community is different by their diets, by their habits, by their nutritional areas. Then we will see if there is any effect of the pharmacogenetics, means genetically is there any effect of the drug, is there any difference of the absorption, distribution, metabolism, elimination and excretion. These parameters are either changed with the genetically changed or not. This will give us an idea, either the answer of those questions, where we can say some drugs are very helpful in the other areas of the world, but they are not helpful in our areas. Reason is, genetically we have no any type of the receptors present in our body, particularly those drugs which are affecting on the directly receptors. And so pharmacogenetics is the study of drug effects including distribution and disposition due to the genetic difference. This type of the study will be called pharmacogenetics. Pharmacogenetics is deals with the genetics, and the which can affect individual response to the drug, both in terms of the therapeutic effect and the adverse effect. This science is basically have another horizon and other areas of the research, because multiple factors affect us, multiple areas where we can check either the behavior of the drug is same as reported in the previous literature, or now we are working in this particular population. If we have the difference, if there is a difference, then dose will be difference. Their mode of action can be explained another way, and other things we can monitor as a pharmacist, especially in case of the pharmacogenetics. Okay, relationship of drug concentration and drug response. As we increasing the drug concentration in the body, we are taking the more response. But this is not so much so common, because when we increase the concentration of drug, we get more concentration of drug in the plasma. But it's not compulsory. This concentration will get we can get more effect, because at the particular concentration, the drug will be converted into the toxic level. And this parameter will also be discussed in this subject. Okay, I have already told you subtherapeutic, potentially subtherapeutic, therapeutic, and potentially toxic. There is another two words which I have already in our previous classes, but there are two main words. We can divide it, okay, therapeutic. Oh, sorry, I erased it first. There are five different levels of a drug in the body which shows the effect, just like a pharmacodynamic effect. One is subtherapeutic level. Other is partially therapeutic level. Other is therapeutic level. And the other is partially toxic level. Last one is toxic level. These are the five areas where the drug exists in our body. Subtherapeutic level, it means they are in that areas where the drug is present in our body. We can measure the concentration of drug in our body from the plasma. And partially subtherapeutic means they have some therapeutic effect, but not required therapeutic effect. And therapeutic level means they have the therapeutic effect and the required dose should be maintained in this area. Partially toxic level means we got some symptoms of the toxicity of the drug. This can be controlled by reducing the concentration of drug into the therapeutic level. And the last level is toxic level, where the concentration of drug is now not useful for the patient, but it can be dangerous for the patients. These are the five areas where the drug exists in the body. And in this class, we will check, we will start some calculations also. I will give you the detailed of the calculations of one pharmacokinetic parameter, which is AUC, area under the curve. Okay, area under the curve can be calculated by using the trapezoidal rule. And first of all, I will give you some graphical presentations. This graph, this one, this graph, and this graph. they have the four different graphs, and they are all between the concentration and time. Concentration and time. This is concentration and time. Concentration and time. When we see this graph, this is only a single line. This line is actually showing the elimination. What it means? This graph is for the injections. Because when injection, particularly IV injections, intravascular injection. When we give the intravascular injection to the patient, drug starts to eliminate. And this elimination will be shown from higher concentration toward the lower concentration. This is called one compartment IV injections graph. In the second graph, we have two lines. One line is this one. This is called distribution. And the other line is the same line which I have already explained in the previous one compartment model. But there is a presence of the distribution and elimination. And in my previous class, I told you when there is a distribution, we will say this is a two compartment. This is IV graph, IV injections graph. This is also IV injection graph, and this is oral graph, oral tablets, and this is oral graph. Main difference between among four is they have the different dosage forms. These two are the from the oral data. Okay, these two are from the IV injections, and these two are IV injections, but IV injection having only elimination, no distribution. And in case of this the second graph, we have a distribution and the elimination. We will say this is the two compartment IV injections. And the other case, here is an absorption and elimination. Distribution is absent. It means it's also one compartment, but for the oral. Because why we are saying oral? Because we are getting the absorption curve first, then elimination. This graph have the three areas: absorption, distribution, and elimination. In case of absorption, the just like the same in the oral IV injection, oral data of the one compartment, but distribution included in the distribution, this shows that we have the two compartment. When we say this is one compartment IV injections graph, this is one compartment IV injections two compartment graph, and this is one compartment oral graph, two compartment oral graph. Means when we give the dosage form into the orally, either syrup, suspension, capsules, tablets, that we will get these type of the behavior of the drugs. Now question is, how can we calculate the area under the curve from these graphs? Before starting the area under the curve, I will tell you some graphical presentations. One graph is rectilinear graph. We also already used in our previous classes linear graph. We use the word linear. Linear means we have the same boxes, same axis, big boxes and their small boxes, at least 10 in a one big division and other is a small big division. I am making this especially, this type of graph is called rectilinear. Why we are saying the linear? Because they have the same sizes at the x. This is called x-axis and this is called y-axis. They have the same sizes of the boxes on the x-axis and the y-axis. X-axis have the same, this is one big division, 0, 1, 2, 3 and 4, and having the small divisions. We already know this graph, this type of the graph. We have already made this graph, this type of the graph in the linearity and those areas, especially when we measure the unknown viscosity, unknown density, unknown surface tension, we make a standard curve. And these type of the standard curve by using the different instruments, by using the refractometer, by using the UV spectrophotometer, viscometer, same other instruments for the calculation of the unknown concentration. This type of the graph is called rectilinear, linear graph. But in case of other graph is semi-log graph, semi-log. The word shows that semi-log. means one side of the graph is logarithmic value, having the logarithmic value, and other is linear, semi-log. Semi means half of the half portion of the drug is logarithmic and half of the drug is non-logarithmic linear. Means x-axis will be the logarithmic or y-axis will be the logarithmic. In the case of semi-log graph, we will see there are the different cycles. One cycle graph, two cycle graph, three cycle. I will suggest you people to visit our website www.boomer.org for pharmacokinetics. When you will visit this site, where you can see the icon which is download, and in case of download, when you will go toward the graph, when at this type of when you go to the graph, there will be the some further explanation of the graph. Two cycle graph, three cycle graph, five cycle graph. Cycle means one segment. You know, logarithm value can be written into the 10 raised to power 1. This show this is equal actually 10. If we write 10 raised to power 2, it means it's 100. And if I write 10 raised to power 3, it means it's 1000. And if I take the log of all these, log 10 raised to power 2, log 10 to the power 1, log 10 to the power 3, answer is 3, answer is 1, answer is 2. It means in case of logarithmic value, we have a base of 10. Base of 10. When we take these areas, these are the cycle of the 10th cycle. Means we, in case of semi-log graph, we will not start from the 0. In case here we can start 0, 5, 10. In the case of rectilinear, I will write linear graph. This one. But in case of semi-log graph, we have a different cycles, and among the cycle we will have to write the logarithmic values on the y-axis and the simple values on the x-axis. When we write the logarithmic values on the y-axis, we are using one-sided log. It means we will use the word semi-log. It means that if there is a linear semi-log, there will be another graph which is called log-log graph. What will be happen? We will take logarithmic values of the both sides. Y-axis and x-axis will be on the same side. In case of semi-log graph, we will not start from the 0. We will start from the 1 or the power of 1. Power of the 1 means 10 raised to power 1, 10, 100, 1000, 10,000. If I write here 1, then here I have to write the 10. Next I have to write the 100, because I am writing the power of 10. Power of 1, and power of 10 means 10 raised to power minus 1, 10 raised to power 1, 10 power 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. As the concentration increasing, we will make that in the 10th power. This type of the graph is called semi-log graph. And the x-axis of this type of the graph are same, just like this one. Boxes are same. Same boxes, big division, small division, and we can start from the 0. There are the two major differences between the logarithm graph, semi-log graph, and the linear graph. In case of linear graph, we have the same axis. X-axis and y-axis, big division, small division, all are same. We will call linear, the word linear. Another difference between the semi-log is we have not the similar same differences. In the case of x-axis, we have the same number of boxes, big division and small division, but on the y-axis, we have the different cycles. This is one cycle, two cycle, three cycle, even five cycle graph. I will explain why we are using this semi-log graph. And the other difference is there is no any logarithmic values, but here is a logarithmic values on x-axis, y-axis. And other difference, we can start from the zero in case of rectilinear or the linear graph on the y-axis, but from the semi-log graph we cannot start from the zero. We can start with the 1, okay, 10, 100, 1000, okay, I come down 1.1, 0.01, 0.001, 0.0001, I can write, but not 0 from y-axis. These are the two major differences between the semi-log and the logarithmic graph. We will use the, all these graphs are the semi-log graph, remember. All these graphs are the semi-log graphs. Because in case of pharmacokinetics, we will make the semi-log graph. And the semi-logarithm graph are using in the case of pharmacokinetics is due to the fluctuation of the drug. Because when we measure the concentration of the drug from the body, we can measure in the microgram per ml, okay, milligram per ml, this is so much, but and picogram per ml, microgram, nanogram per ml, picogram per ml, you know the units. If I write the microgram per ml, there is a nanogram per ml also, okay, there is a milligram per ml, and then picogram per ml. These units are have, the words are the very simple, but they have the difference of the three. Micro means 10 raised to power minus 6. Milli means 10 power minus 3. Nano means 10 power minus 9. This means difference of the three digits. And if I have the concentration in the microgram per ml and other concentration in the nanogram per ml, it means I have the difference between the 10 three digits. And the three digits, when we want to explain at the linear graph, it's impossible for me. Then I will go to that area where the difference between these values can be overcome, and these values can be overcome by taking the logarithmic values. And so we will make the 1, 10, 100 and 1000, and we easily can construct the graph and we can easily measure the concentrations. This was some introduction about the definition. We in this class, we learn some words, especially starting material, okay, API, active pharmaceutical ingredient, then NDA approach, new drug application, ANDA approach, abbreviated new drug applications, generic drug, clinical pharmacokinetics, pharmacogenetics, pharmacodynamics, and also the two ways or to calculate the pharmacokinetics, statistical way, and other is our experimental way. Then we move towards the clinical pharmacokinetic aspects, where we understand the value of the TDM, therapeutic drug monitoring, and also the some techniques which we are using in the clinical pharmacokinetics. Now we are moving towards our basics of the pharmacokinetics, which is actually the concept of the drug concentration in our body. To understand these areas, we start with the graphical representation of the IV injections, two compartment IV injection bolus, and then oral, and then we make some concept of the graphs. There are the two basic types of the graph. One is linear, another is semi-log. And in our pharmacokinetics, in the whole study, we will make the semi-log graphs. And these semi-log are called semi-log because one side of the graph is logarithmic value and other is the non-logarithmic value. Thank you very much for your patience and also the listening. I hope you will understand all these concepts. Thank you very much.